WCCF, this is Charlotte County Speaks. Ken Lovejoy with you on a hump day Wednesday. 9-11 is the time. Phone lines are open at 941-206-1580. Toll free, 888-441-1580. You can email us, the address ccspeaks@live.com. And if you miss a show, you can find them all at spreaker.com under WCCF. Today is a very special curmudgeon hump day. We have Dr. Pitts and Ned in the house.
Yes, you
gentlemen,
do.
Gentlemen. And as you recall, what is it, a couple of weeks ago, we had a debate challenge by Dave Kalin and Commissioner Joe Tiseo. And this was the day that they were both available on. So today, it's a curmudgeon debate day.
The first in the history of the whole
the whole shebang.
Bang.
That's not
and
true.
And if it works out, we'll have a lot more of those.
That's not true. Every time you go to a curmudgeon meeting, they're debating.
That's true. I brought Ned Byrne with me. Ned is a fellow curmudgeon, Wall Street, a retired Wall Street, has all the numbers at his fingertips. So.
Oh yeah, sure.
It should be. Well, it's good enough. Believe me. And so, you know, I'm a guest, and
okay,
you're the host, so knock yourself out.
Well, we there apparently was some contention here, and that I find unusual. Dave, tell us what you found some issues with the budget, just kind of give us your side here.
There were no specific issues to the budget. Many people know I was a former commissioner in the state of Pennsylvania. We reduced our budgets, our taxation, as well as our pension costs by making policy changes, standing up to the unions and making those changes. So I have a little experience with that. But what really kind of precipitated this was a comment that I made about my fire tax increasing substantially on some properties.
Yeah.
Now, I think there's some confusion here. I own just about 10 acres in the Charlotte Ranchettes, which I run my farm from, and I have my home on there. And then I lease just about 146 acres throughout the county that I keep bees on. Some of them have homes. Some of them are vacant lots. Some of them are agricultural exempted. So when the public hearing notice came out for the fire tax increase, I was a little shocked to see my personal residence, which is also partially bona fide as a farm and homesteaded, go from the $203 to $764.13, as well as a vacant lot having a substantial jump. Now, not having access immediately to all the leased lots, because I do pay property taxes or portions of property taxes on a number of those lots, every agreement that I have is a little bit different based on what they're able to provide for either bees or plants. I also have a nursery. With all that, you start to extrapolate numbers. As a businessman, you've got to figure, okay, what's this impact going to be this year? The number was actually much higher than I originally quoted, roughly 15,000. I reduced it to the 15, saying, hey, we've got to do something about this, only to find out after the public hearing, which, by the way, having it at the Murdoch location was just not the proper venue for the number of people that showed up. Folks were out in the hallway. People were outside. People were standing in the parking lot. You couldn't hear anything. There was no closed caption for the longest time. My wife's deaf. There was no closed caption. She could not see what was going on the screen. There was nothing. And so it was a little bit of mayhem out in the hallways. People weren't being heard. I think one gentleman even referenced, gentlemen, this is a public hearing, and the public's outside, and they can't hear you. So having it at the event center was a better venue, only it was a dollar short and a day late because people by that point had already spoke their piece, if they could speak their piece. And only a handful showed up. But after all this happened, initially, I also ended up in the hospital in the meantime, some health issues, which is why I didn't respond to Mr. Tiseo's emails immediately here, and then ended up having a conversation later. I got my trim notice. Now, my trim notice, then I subsequently went into the office and spoke to them. They had the correct numbers for the fire tax that I was going to be receiving, $254 a year, not the $764 for my main property.
Well, so, that's good news.
Absolutely, absolutely. So what it comes down to is at the end of the day, my total hit for everything, if I choose to continue to lease the properties that I currently lease, is just a hair under $5,000 increase. I can reduce that down. I don't need to keep all those properties on inventory out there for bees or for plants. I can bring those back to other properties. I can bring them back to my own properties and reduce that cost. So that at that point becomes my choice to reduce that cost. Where I was a little frustrated was just having gotten out of the hospital, not even 30 minutes out of the hospital, when I received a phone call from Commissioner Tiseo to talk about this. And I explained to him, look, I literally just got out of the hospital. Let's talk about this another time. We'll go through the budget. Well, you said there's bloat in the budget. We'll talk about it another time. I know he shot me an email. I didn't even check that email. I laid in bed for a better part of a week and a half, almost 2 weeks in bed. And normally my wife will handle my emails when I'm not feeling so well, which doesn't happen too often. Most people know I'm a go, go, go kind of guy. My poor wife was in bed with shingles. She's bedridden for about a week and a half. We had the double whammy in that household.
Damn.
We did not show up to committee meetings. We were not showing up to any of the club meetings. Missed my first REC meeting in the history of me being a member of the REC. That doesn't happen. Phone was flooding in with calls, whether it be friends, Dr. Pitts, a number of others. I wasn't even answering the phone. I was out. So to then hear on this radio show that I'm non-responsive, yeah, for good reason. Yeah. Him and I had subsequently, before the radio show, had a conversation at the REC. And it was a little contentious, and I blew it off. The radio show is kind of what precipitated this little bit of angst going on. And, you know, I respect Commissioner Tiseo. I don't know what it's like to be a commissioner. You're an elected official. Either people love you or people hate you. There's not a whole lot of middle-of-the-road folks out there anymore.
Well, but again, what's the issue, though?
So that issue was over the fire tax issue, and I wanted to have a conversation, and then he brought up the, well, you said there was bloat in the budget. Well, you can start going through the budget line by line, and you start to find a little here, a little there. Last night at the budget hearing, a gentleman got up, made a comment about the cost of the gateways we're putting in the county. For those that don't know what a gateway is, you get the big sign, welcome to Charlotte County, mm-hmm. Purple Heart community, you know, all the niceties, the plants, the palm trees, all that stuff costs money. The gentleman spoke to costing over $1 million. Mr. Tiseo made the comment that that's false information. It's only $250,000, yet in August, a contract was signed with V&H Construction for the one out here. It's a Kings Highway Pathway and Community Feature Sign construction for $944,614.65. That combined with the $200,000 over on 41, the gentleman was not far off in his numbers. And the public can get up and speak. When I was a commissioner in Pennsylvania, the public can get up and speak. They have issues. They're near and dear to them. We're in an economic downturn. I got elected after the 08 collapse. I was the guy who got called in to elected to clean up the mess. And we're heading into a very similar financial time. Only when you start to look at inverted yield curves, this is worse than 1928 heading into the 29 collapse. Yet we're not drawing back. I'm forced to draw back. I'm forced to reduce my outlay because of the cost of inflation, the cost of fuel, food. As we all know, food and fuel are not in the inflationary rate. If they were, people's heads would be spinning and blood would be shooting from their eyes because they'd be so upset with what's going on in our government accountability.
Okay, I get this, but what is your issue with Joe Tiseo? Because, you know, what you're mentioning here, we've seen what you've said on, know, in the commission meetings. They're out there. But I've read the emails.
Oh, yeah. There's
that,
more emails.
That Joe sent. And the emails that I see is Joe responding to a constituent saying, hey, let's get together and show me where this bloat is before the budget hearings. And then your illness occurred and you were not available. You didn't respond. No phone calls.
And we had a conversation then subsequently at an REC. And it spiraled out of control from a budgetary issue because there were emails sent to my campaign wanting to know who my whistleblowers are, who's on my election integrity team. And for me, you don't give up your sources. Otherwise,
sources. If you're a citizen journalist, fine, but you're running for supervisor of election.
Absolutely.
And you're claiming that the 2022 election in Charlotte County was a disaster. Well, it's kind of incumbent on you to bring the receipts and show exactly what you're talking about. And instead of just waiting until today, why haven't you sent that stuff to the Secretary of State?
I have. I was told not to rock the boat. It was also sent to the governor's office. We were told not to rock the boat.
Who told you not to rock the boat?
Staffer from the governor's office.
Okay. All right, look, can I get some equal time?
Yeah, yeah. Let me take a break. We're coming back with Joe Desea. We'll be right back on News Radio 1580.
That's a great radio station.
Best in town.
We'll be right back with Charlotte County Speaks on News Radio 1580 WCCF.
So Disney announces that they're going to be spending $60 billion on its theme parks and cruises, making a major investment there. And
Judy was boring.
Hello.
Then Judy discovered chumbacasino.com.
It's my little escape.
Now Judy's the life of the party.
Oh baby, mama's bringing home the bacon.
Whoa, take it easy, Judy. The Chumba life is for everybody. So go to chumbacasino.com and play over 100 casino style games. Join today and play for free for your chance to redeem some serious prizes. ChumbaCasino.com. No purchase necessary. Void where prohibited by law. 18 plus terms and conditions apply. See website for details.
Do you hear that? That is the sound of BMW performance without a single piston or cylinder. A generation of all-electric vehicles designed and built like no other. The BMW iX, i7, and i4 revolutionize every drive into a thrilling opportunity to feel the pure rush of BMW 100% electric. But isn't that what you'd expect from the ultimate electric driving machine? Take advantage of exceptional lease and finance offers today.
Need to do that, need to compete with Universal and other places. But what really Disney really needs at this point in time is to revitalize its brand. You did a ton of damage. You really did. And quite frankly, you've got more damage coming down the pike. Your insistence on ridiculous woke programming has turned off ungodly sums of Americans that won't go back to your parks. It's just that simple. You've got a Snow White movie coming out where the lead actress is basically bashing Snow White. Have you guys lost your minds for crying out loud? Revitalize your brand. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com.
News Radio 1580 and 100.9 FM, WCCF, Charlotte County Speaks. Hump Day Wednesday, 9:26 is the time. Curmudgeons in the house along with Supervisor of Elections candidate David Kalin and Commissioner Joe Tesseo. We had Mr. Kalin with the first segment. Commissioner Tesseo, you're up.
Yeah, thank you, Ken. Yeah, so how this thing started, we had our budget hearing in July, and Mr. Kalin came into the chamber and indicated he line-itemed our budget, and it was bloated. He also indicated that the commissioners are paying a different rate than other people for their taxes. Subsequently, he came on the show and also claimed that his taxes were going up $15,000 from the fire rate proposal. So I was taking notes, and then I reached out to Mr. Kalin. I called him. I had his personal cell phone. He has mine. We've discussed other issues in the past. And I said, Dave, I've got your comments here. I said, you know, can you tell me how your taxes have gone up that much from this proposal? Because I haven't heard from anybody in the agricultural community. And if taxes were going up that much from the fire fee in the agricultural community, I would have gotten phone calls ringing off the hook. So, he told me he wasn't feeling well. We were on the phone for a little bit, and I said, that's fine. We'll follow up later. So this is the email I sent. Mr. Kalin, as we discussed, you were going to send me a fire fee notice on one of your rented properties. I have been unable to find anything that would cause a $17,000 increase to your rent from the proposed fire rate. I made a mistake. It was supposed to be $15,000. I put $17,000. You were also going to send me your line item review of our budget and indicate where we are bloated. I look forward to reviewing these matters. I followed up again and said a week or two later, on August 2nd, I said, it has been almost a week. I have not heard back from you regarding my email. Our final budget hearings are quickly approaching, so I'll need that information so I can look into the matter. Regards, Joe Tiseo. On the phone, he said...
That's on your
county
email.
County emails, yeah. It's a matter of record. Everything I have here is a matter of public record. So as a commissioner, I'm reaching out to Mr. Kalin. It's everything that he would want in a commissioner. He said that publicly before, that he, you know, you should have your commissioner's cell phone, you should be able to talk to your commissioner to work out issues, and I did exactly what he expects from a locally elected official. Came on the show to do an update, and you would ask me, hey, what's going on with this fire fee? I had a guy named Kalin call in saying it was going up $15,000, and then we started to have a discussion about that, and I told you he never responded. Mr. Kalin called the show and said the reason he didn't respond to the emails was because, not because what he just said, that he was sick and all these other excuses. He said he didn't want to respond to the email because he's under no obligation to give me his personal information about who he leases property from, if you remember that. That's why he did not respond. It wasn't because he didn't get my emails. It wasn't because he was sick. He acknowledged he got my emails. He just didn't respond because he said it was none of my business. However, that's not what is memorialized in these emails. These are like extemporaneous notes, because right after the discussion, soon thereafter, I put, as we discussed, you were going to send me a fire fee notice of one of your rented properties. He agreed to do it. But I think what happened, he realized there was no $15,000 increase. It was a complete fabrication, so he didn't want to send me those. Because the answer to all this would be, send me all your rented properties and show me where you had a $15,000 increase. Real simple. That would have put an end to the whole thing. I could have examined those fire fee notices to see if they were valid, if it was $15,000. So as a matter of public record, I looked up two pieces of property that Mr. Kalin rents. He rents from a Mr. Michael Anthony Schloss. And as you can see here, he's got the agricultural classification on that rented property. If you go back to non-ad valorem, classified ag property is exempt from the fire fee. There is no fee there. I found another one of his rented properties. It's all Mr. Schloss's properties. That was Glenmar Farms. He disclosed that as that was a tenant that he was a tenant for that particular property. As you can see here, there's no fire fee rate. So if you have an agriculturally classified property and using it for bona fide farming use, you're exempt from the fire fee. If your homestead is on it, your homestead is not exempt. In Mr. Kalin's case, his homestead has never been exempt. As a matter of fact, you're responsible, according to the tax code, to pay for your homestead and the curtilage, which is the property directly surrounding your home. It could be a detached garage, things that are ancillary to your homestead. So last year, Mr. Kalin paid for three units on his property. I guess the appraiser picked up his house and a couple of outstructures. This is last year's taxes. He paid those. This year, a tax notice went out for the same three units. However, the state passed a law July 1st that you couldn't charge for those ancillary structures. So now he's only being charged for his house. So actually, Mr. Kalin personally had a net reduction in his fire tax on his homestead. It went down to just one unit. So he saved $300 or $400. So he actually has a net savings. So even if he was renting property agriculturally and it's classified, he's paying nothing. If there is a charge, it's because it doesn't have the classification, and there would be a per unit acre charge. I think it's like $54. So no matter, he said he rents 100 acres, even if I gave him all 100 acres is not classified agriculture and the $54 applied, he's paying a few thousand dollars. But he's been unable to show me the tax bills for those properties so I can see what he paid last year and what he paid this year, because those taxes didn't go up to the extent that he's saying. And so I just wanted to make that clear. He hasn't produced any of those documents, and he claimed he wrapped himself in the cloak of privacy. Even though I didn't ask to see the leases, I don't want to know who the terms of his lease or the length. I just asked for the property addresses so I could confirm the tax increase that he claimed. So I have still been unable to find a $15,000 increase from his rented properties because he's refused to produce those things, even though he agreed to in our original phone call, which is memorialized in my email. He just decided not to respond. So, I mean, and also I'd like to say, since you were here during that discussion, at our public hearing, Mr. Kalin described my actions on the show as blasting him, and a matter of public record. His wife came up to speak and said, my comments on the show were vicious and disgusting. I don't know. You were sitting in that seat. I don't know if I would characterize it as that. But however, that's how it was characterized. And the reason I bring this up, and Mr. Kalin brought it up earlier, he's a candidate running for supervisor elections. He's put himself out as in the public arena to have his public comments verified. So everything here is a matter of public record. He's running on honesty. He's running on transparency is the cornerstone of what he's running on. Yet his actions during this request to resolve his problems, he's wrapped himself in the cloak of secrecy and has been non-responsive. So as a commissioner, I don't know what I could do more than call, make a personal call to say, I hear you. You clearly have some issues. They concern me when I hear a tax increase like that because I couldn't figure out how that happened. And then his line item of the budget, I said, come on in. Let's go over your line item and let me see if I could find something that I can bring back to the budget hearing. And the fact that he said that we're paying a different tax rate than other taxpayers, that somehow the commissioners are getting a break on their taxes, I can't understand any of that. I lived in the same home. I built my home in 1999, lived in it all these years. I have the same homestead exemptions available to anybody else. The tax assessor assesses my property. I pay over $5,000 in taxes on my property. I'm treated the same way any other taxpayer would under the same conditions, yet he's claiming I pay a different tax rate. So when you start saying things like that, you know, as a public candidate running for public office, I mean, at some point you're responsible for what you say. I mean, you've put yourself out there for public scrutiny. I had to do it when I was a candidate. I was aware that any time I was out in the public and made comments, I was subject to scrutiny. That's just the way it is. So he's been unable to produce the documents that I had requested. And I asked him, you know, you don't even have to do it. I'll do it. Just give me the addresses. And he just refused to do so. So I don't know why, but his excuse of being sick and these other things he just told you is not true. Because on the show, he said, I'm not responding because I'm not giving you the information because it's private. So now he's changed his story again.
You and I had the conversation at the REC long before this radio show.
No, we didn't. It was after the radio show we had the conversation at the REC.
I actually referenced your actions in the radio show that happened at the REC.
Okay. No, you didn't.
Are you serious?
I'm sorry. On the radio show, yes. But at the REC, it was another issue. So I want to stick to this. Then we'll get to that so we don't conflate the two issues.
So, again, the notice sent to me.
Where are the tax bills from your commercial properties that I can look at and see the increases? Well, the increases from last year, where are they? So that's real simple. You can put it to bed right now.
For the ones I lease?
Yeah, you said the increase was coming from the ones you lease was $15,000. Just show me the tax bills.
And that number was extrapolated because many of those are non-residents of the United States. So I did not have all those notices, the hearing notices. So when I'm calculating numbers, I'm basing it on what I'm seeing on what I was mailed.
So you received no tax notices from your landlord saying your taxes are going up?
No.
You did it all yourself?
Based on these numbers, and let me tell you, the bulk of the properties I lease are not agricultural exempted. They are residential lots.
$54 an acre.
So when you go out to the Charlotte Ranchettes, they are taxed, they're zoned agricultural, but they are taxed at vacant residential. It's a taxation issue. The entirety is zoned agricultural, but they're taxed at vacant residential, which means there's fire tax on those ag properties, unless they've become bona fide ag exempted.
Yeah, it's $54.
Yes.
So where
you
are
start
your tax
to add
bills?
Up those numbers in short period between the two, not able to get out to all the property owners. This is what I extrapolated.
You just have to.
Be
you just
up
have to.
Could you please not interrupt? Because I did not interrupt you.
Okay.
So then you get into the different tax rate for you and the others. My personal property that my house is on, this year, the assessed value went up 28%. Another vacant property I have, the assessed value went up 292%. Another vacant farm property, agriculturally exempted, 37%. Another vacant lot, agriculturally exempted, 42%. Another ag-exempted property, 51%. Those are not your normal tax increase rates on vacant property. So you start to ask, your rates didn't go up comparably.
I don't have vacant property. My taxes went up too, as well, on my homestead.
I'm talking about my homestead. Did your homestead go up 28%?
I don't. You know what? I paid, I think, 40. I went up $300, so on a maybe 9%. I don't know, whatever it was.
So it's a,
but it went up.
It's a different amount when nothing. And I'm sitting with $362,000 in hurricane damage, which is a whole nother topic that I'd like to get into.
So let's focus back on the actual bill. So here's the bottom line, Ken. Mr. Kalin doesn't have anything from the county for his commercial properties demonstrating a $15,000 increase.
They're not commercial properties.
His ag properties that he rents, I'm sorry. He has nothing regarding his ag properties. What he just testified to here is that he came up with it himself. He extrapolated himself. He essentially taxed himself $15,000. So it's real simple. He hasn't produced anything. He's holding up some papers. What does that mean? It means nothing. He needs to show me the commercial properties, the agricultural properties that he leases that he claimed went up $15,000. At the public budget hearing we had a few weeks ago, he came in and claimed that they went up substantially, maybe not 15, but they're still substantial. So he's had time to gather those tax. It's all, you can go online, give me the addresses, I'll look them up myself. He has been unable to do that. That's the bottom line. He made the number up.
No, once he has the nothing numbers to back were extrapolated from this, I said up to. Now, with that,
do you have the a tax
has,
bill?
The finish. Number has been reduced, and I have just said that here, the number was reduced based on the incorrect numbers that were sent by the county to do my rough calculations.
So
my taxes are going to be.
So what's your tax?
I have no need to come back in with all the documentation. Once everything has been sorted through and you realize that you guys sent the wrong numbers on some of my property, and that's where you're basing numbers from, and you go, okay, it's now been corrected. It's a much smaller amount. I can live with that amount, or I can choose not to continue to lease those properties. My choice to do. I don't need to sit here and continue to go back and forth on personal business items with you. And I've made that very clear. It's a much less number. Had I had the correct numbers from the county from the beginning, my conversation would have never been had at your board for that higher number. It's based on the numbers you guys sent incorrect.
He's produced nothing that shows we sent correct numbers. He's holding up some papers. Nobody. Numbers.
This is the hearing notice.
Yeah, you think
the hearing notice.
I mean, how am I supposed to look at this? I've been asking for this information for weeks. I can come in here with papers and flash them around and say it's wrong. I have no idea if that's incorrect or not. He has not provided me with any documentation.
You just acknowledged yourself that due to the state statute that I'm billed for one unit, you guys are billing me for three units.
For your homestead, not your rented property. That's your homestead.
Correct. But when you're running those numbers and looking at this going, okay, I've got a number of properties that have homes. I pay a portion of the taxes. I lease their yards. I lease their vacant lots that are attached to their yards or to their homestead. I am getting stuck with part of this bill. And when I have an incorrect amount, it should have been $254, not $764. So if I am calculating my potential risk, I'm going off of the documents you sent me, the county sent me, to calculate those. On average, because if you calculate this out, if it was every property, it'd be about $30,000. I never even once referenced to that high amount. So when it comes down to it, right here it is. This is from you, from your office.
So here's what he's claiming. He's claiming that his lease properties, agricultural lease properties for his farming activities, he calculated that himself. He's already admitted he hasn't gotten anything from the county on those specific properties. He's using a homestead notice to his homestead, and he's taking these numbers and he just decided to apply it to all his properties that he leases. That's what he's testifying to now.
No, I'm not. I'm saying a number of those properties. Yeah. Are you not listening to me?
Look,
you're a good spin doctor on this one. The
problem is that when you reach out to a constituent and ask to come in and provide the documents so you can sit down in a proper forum to sort through all these things, you're supposed to be responsive, you know, if you have a concern. And he didn't. And he claimed he didn't because he wasn't going to disclose who he rents properties from. He did that on the show. Now he's got a new thing. He's claiming he's got an erroneous document that I can't possibly verify now because he's showing it to me right now. So, I mean, the bottom line is his taxes did not go up $15,000. And until he shows me those addresses to the properties he leases is the only way to determine what they actually went up, because they shouldn't have even gone up what he's claiming, because many of them, as I just cited, are classified ag. There's no fee. There's no fee. And he was paying taxes, fire tax, on those last year. So it should be relatively the same this year. He's claiming the increase caused, the new assessment causes his fee to go up. It should be minimal, if anything. And he's refused to show any of those things, and that would have put this to bed a long time ago. And he said he won't disclose that. So what can I do when you offer help and he won't disclose public documents? I just don't know. The samples I found were ones that he publicly said he had, but he won't give me the other addresses. That would settle the whole matter.
Let's talk about the one address, Mr. Schloss's property.
Yeah.
That's actually Prana Farms.
Yeah.
They have a great distrust for the county, as do I with it, which is one of the reasons they didn't want any of their information out there, any of the others that
it's
I'm
public.
Dealing with. It's public. It is
right.
Public, but as far as discussing it. So I'm going to discuss some of it because this has been a point of contention with code hearings.
Look, let's not get into code compliance right now. We can shift to another
because
gear.
Because this is something you and I have discussed.
I know we discussed it.
And I've gotten your emails, and your emails have not resolved the issue. So pardon me for not trusting you a little bit, because we're still going through the code hearing process when Charlotte County has repeatedly violated state statute.
Yeah. Well, look, that's for the code compliance officer. They're independent from the commission. You have your day in court and your due diligence. I watched your code meeting there, and apparently you have an RV on a property that you're claiming is an office, and I think code compliance picked it up as a residence. So I understand the dispute, and you're entitled to dispute that. And if it is an office used for bona fide agricultural use, you're entitled to an exemption. And you're entitled to have that there. And you're going through that process
now. It is exempted.
Yeah.
That's the thing. It is exempted.
Well, the hearing examiner granted a continuance, and he's going to come back, and if you're correct, he'll grant that. But that has nothing to do with the board. So I'm just saying, what we're talking about here is...
It does have something to do with the board, because you guys set up a task force to go out and start looking at these properties and going after
every property. We don't have a task force. We have code compliance, the same code compliance that you had as a Kumru County Commissioner. You voted as a Kumru County Commissioner on every ordinance that came before them. You voted for a maintenance ordinance. You voted for a curfew ordinance. Mm-hmm. You voted for putting grass clippings in the road ordinance. You supported a maintenance ordinance. You expanded code compliance in Kumru and directed the city manager to hire more code compliance officers. Yet here, your public statements are completely opposite. You said you'd do away with code compliance here in Charlotte County.
No, I did not.
Yes, you did.
I said I'd reduce it.
Okay.
Reduce it.
You said you'd reduce it. Okay.
You've got to take code enforcement and look at the human factor. And there are times when they're out of control. I'll give you an example. A gentleman was fined $4,500 for a flat tire. Multiple different vehicles ended up with a flat tire in his driveway, but $4,500 fine from Charlotte County for a flat tire.
All right, here's Commissioner Kalen, candidate.
The nitpicking.
Okay. So, and he went on to say he would get rid of it.
No, he said I would reduce it.
So, I'm just saying that
they
Mr.
need a full overhaul.
Mr. Kalen's record and his statements publicly are two different things. Here, in 2010, he's 2011. He seconded a motion to file liens against properties with maintenance issues passed. As a commissioner candidate, he said, no one should tell you how to maintain your property. He also said, if you were elected, you would get rid of code compliance. He made a motion to adopt an ordinance for fines and liens if you deposit grass clippings in a township road. He passed another ordinance for a curfew for minors from 6 to 10, and on Saturday and Sunday, you got to stay out to 11. I mean, this is...
Oh, that was nice.
Yeah, that was real nice. So, for a guy who says he'd get rid of code compliance, reduce it, and that government's running your life, his actions as a actual commissioner when he had a chance to stand up to these things. He also said publicly that when his colleagues, his commissioner, would come up with these crazy ordinances, he'd stand up and fight and tell them why they shouldn't pass it. Out of the 4 years of meeting minutes that I've examined, not once did he stand up and shoot down an ordinance. He either was a motion maker or a second on the motion or voted unanimously to approve every single ordinance that came through as a commissioner. That's completely opposite from what he said publicly about code compliance. So I don't know how you're able to actually reconcile that, your record, with actually what you're saying.
So the meeting minutes. Those are not audio minutes, are they?
Guys, we got to take a break. Yeah. We'll be right back.
Today's show is brought to you absolutely free. Radio's the only thing that's not hitting you up for money or personal information. It's easy to use, and again, it's totally free. You're welcome. We'll be right back with Charlotte County Speaks on News Radio 1580 WCCF.
I watched the Discovery Channel, yes. And you know what I discovered? I need a girlfriend. That's right. Yes, yeah. No, I did. And the more of you watch, the less chance you ever have of meeting a woman. Because it fills your head full of odd facts that come out at any moment like a Tourette syndrome. I'm talking to a girl. I'm like, how you doing? Did you know Hitler was ticklish? Well, yeah. I don't have a girlfriend, but sometimes I like to pretend I do. I just stand in my apartment screaming, hey, no, that's not what I said. No. I didn't say that. Excuse me.
My record and in Coomer Township, dealing with curfews, dealing with grass clippings and roads, as Mr. Sayo has pulled up. Let me look at that and say, how many folks understand what Coomer Township is? Not many people do. It's a very mountainous region. A lot of steep roads, tight turns.
Before Sarah discovered ChumbaCasino.com, she enjoyed chamomile tea.
Come on, big jackpot.
And being in PJs by 6.
Let's go.
The new fun Sarah.
Woohoo!
Often thinks about the old boring Sarah.
Yes.
And wonders if that Sarah ever really existed.
Chumba Casino has over 100 casino-style games. So join today and play for free for your chance to redeem some serious prizes.
No purchase necessary. Void where prohibited by law. 18 plus. Terms and conditions apply. See website for details.
Very hilly area. Very mountainous area. And when you have a huge number of properties dumping grass clippings into the road while they mow, and you've got, whether it be vehicles or motorcycles, we had such an exorbitant number of motorcycle accidents happening in the area due to the grass clippings in the road, it became necessary to try to save some lives and say, look, don't put your grass clippings in the road. That's not where they belong. They belong in your yard. Now, on the break, Mr. DeSale was, I put my grass clippings out in the road. Well, you know what? If I was a motorcycle rider, I'd probably be pretty upset with you if I wrecked my bike on your grass clippings, because grass clippings don't go on the road. And when you talk to that, the very reason you guys would not allow the ranchettes to take material from the side of the road and put it into the road was because the grass clippings. You couldn't have grass in the road. So that right there is a duplication of it, only with motorcycles on paved roads, on mountains, very dangerous. Now, the curfew issue you want to talk about, we're coming out of the 08 market collapse. Our area was hit exceptionally hard. We had a secondary issue where they took out our entire business district and put in a highway, Route 222, the whole way through. We lost everything up there as far as economics. We had youth coming out of the city, breaking into homes, cars, stealing signs. We were at that point of how do you deal with the youth coming out of the city doing destructive damage to personal property and government property? Well, your option is to throw every single kid in jail. keep your police force working 24 hours a day, throwing them in jail, or you create an ordinance that says the kids, because it's very specific at the kids that were creating the issue, to stop it. You're going to be out in the street. You better be coming home from work. You better be doing something constructive, because if you're just out creating mayhem or you're just out creating a problem, that's an issue.
Okay. And you know what? I understand that. I understand that. You have your reasons as an elected official. I understand that as well, because at both points, you know, he was a commissioner, I'm a commissioner. There are reasons how you come up with ordinance to solve some type of problem. It's no different in Charlotte County. So I'll give him those reasons. My point is this, is that when we have our ordinances here for our community based on something that may have happened, in Mr. Kalin's opinion, we're overreaching. It's government overreach. So while he has excuses for his ordinances, for some reason, our ordinances, we don't get the same benefit that we're trying to solve a problem. That's the difference. He comes in and says we're infringing on his personal rights, on his property rights. When he had maintenance ordinances, it's okay for him in Cumbro, but for us, it's no good. That's my point. I understand. I can give him those arguments. It sounds logical to me. If there's breaking in, things like that, and the community accepted those things, well, that's his community. They accepted the curfew. If they accepted his maintenance codes, that's fine. And the grass clippings, if it's specific to his community, that's fine. It was a public hearing. They made the case, passed the ordinances. I get all that. We don't get the same treatment here in Charlotte County, is my point. He rails against code compliance here and doesn't give us the same courtesy to say, well, it went through a public hearing. We voted for these things to meet a need of the community. That's my point. I mean, you talk about things that he's done as a commissioner in Cumbro County, since he's brought that up in his run for supervisor elections. He said one of his brightest moments was to convert the pension plans in Cumbro from defined benefit guaranteed pension plans to 401k plans. Interestingly enough, I checked the record, and I have an audit here from Berks County, Pennsylvania, from the auditor, general auditor of record, and I also checked Cumbro records. There is no 401k plan.
No, there isn't.
And he claims on his website that he converted them to a 401k plan and saved millions. Yeah, you did. It's on your website.
401k style.
No, that's not what's on your website.
401k style plan.
That's not what's on your website.
They take it with them. They can move it to another job. Whereas with that state guaranteed pension, you die, you lose it. Your family loses it.
All right, we're out of time for this hour. We've got a fake news radio update on the way. We'll be back after that on News Radio 1580.
CCF Punta Gorda.
News Radio 1580.
Charlotte County's only news talk radio station, serving you around the clock.
Uncle Nearest is the most awarded bourbon and American whiskey for 2020, 2021, and 2022. Blended by four-time Master Blender of the Year, Victoria Edie Butler, the great-great-granddaughter of Nearest Green, the first known African-American master distiller, proudly served throughout the United States in your favorite bar and restaurants. To find your location, visit us at UncleNearest.com. Please enjoy responsibly. Must be 21 years old to purchase. 50% alcohol by volume. Uncle Nearest Incorporated, Shelbyville, Tennessee.
With Lucky Land Slots, you can get lucky just about anywhere.
Dearly beloved, we are gathered here today to... Has anyone seen the bride and groom?
Sorry, sorry, we're here. We were getting lucky in the limo and we lost track of time.
No, Lucky Land Casino, with cash prizes that add up quicker than a guest registry.
In that case, I pronounce you lucky.
Play for free at LuckyLandSlots.com. Daily bonuses are waiting. No purchase necessary. Void where prohibited by law. 18 plus. Terms and conditions apply. See website for details.
Wednesday, Gary.
I know that, Janet.
Today, we're celebrating National Punch Day. Oh, not that kind of punch. Rude.
Punch. We need punch.
Punch, punch. Ultimate punch.
In honor of National Punch Day.
What are we drinking?
What are we drinking?
Let me get you a fruit punch.
Ooh, I love punching.
Don't drink too much punch.
It is National Punch Day.
Happy National Punch Day.
It's showtime.
In this present crisis, government is not the solution to our problem. Government is the problem.
This is Charlotte County Speaks, your chance to let your voice be heard on local, state, and national issues. And now, broadcasting live, from a dumpy little warehouse behind a Taco Bell. The host of Charlotte County Speaks, Ken Lovejoy.
News Radio 1580 and 100.9 FM WCCF. This is Charlotte County Speaks. 10:08 is the time on this hump day Wednesday. Our email address is ccspeaks@live.com. And if you miss a show, find them all at spreaker.com under WCCF. We've got the curmudgeons, David Kalin, Joe Taseo in the house. Where were we?
Yeah, I was looking up on the Mr. Kalin's website regarding his negotiations in Coomer County as a commissioner with the pension plans up there.
Coomer Township, just so we're clear on that.
Coomer Township, yeah. So it says, during his term, one of his greatest achievements involved negotiations with the union to transfer from guaranteed pensions, which were bankrupting the local municipality, and pensions to a 401k pension. This new union contract was a groundbreaking landmark initiative. So when I went back and looked in the township, they had two types of pensions, for uniformed and non-uniformed. The uniformed pensions, firefighters and police, they all stayed the same. That pension never changed. The non-uniformed pension changed to a cash balance pension fund, which the employer puts the contribution in, and they guarantee the rate of return, unlike a 401k. So 401k, you put your contributions in.
You're at the mercy of the market.
You're at the mercy of the market. So if the market tanks, your money evaporates. The pension plan they shifted to was nothing like a 401k plan. And this is for non-uniformed. It's a cash balance fund pension plan. And the county's on the hook for guaranteeing you your rate of return, regardless of where the market goes. So the employer's making the contributions, not the employee, and the guarantee is coming from the employer. So it's a little bit different from a guarantee pension plan in some respects. However, it's nothing like a 401k plan. When you read his website, he says they did negotiated with the unions and went all to 401k. That simply is not the case. None of the plans that are in place now resemble a 401k plan. None of them. The plans that are in place are guaranteed. So I'm not sure where he's going with that, but that claim is not correct. There is no 401k plan in Coomer Township.
It was a 401k style that we put in place at the time, and it got away from the guaranteed pension. Now, if you know anything about Pennsylvania pension plans, when you are a state worker, county worker, municipal worker, they are separate pensions than you have from the FOP, uniformed officers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
At the time, we didn't have much of a plan for our firefighters. We had just brought on a chief. Everything was volunteer services before I got into office up there. So that slowly became an additional pension liability over there. But the non-uniform workers had a guaranteed pension that they didn't have to contribute. The municipality had to pay the payments 100%, and you were guaranteed a rate for the rest of your life. And when you died, you lost it. Every dollar. It was gone. Went back in the pot. Your family didn't get it. Nobody else got it. It was non-transferable. With the new plan, it was transferable. You were able to, your family received that pension. You owned that pension. You could also add additional money of your own to it. It was very much like a 401k at the time. This is back in 2010, 2011, 13. And looking at the ways to save that money was a phenomenal reduction in what we were paying, because we no longer had to meet the state's maximum amount to bring it back. So after the 08 collapse, most of those pension funds were underfunded. So if you had a downturn year where you had less revenues coming in and the pension fund lost money, you were required within 1 year to return that to the original funded amount. Now, if the amount went higher and the new funding amount was a much higher amount because it attained a higher market value, you were required to sustain that amount. Under the new pension plan, we were not. It reduced the cost to the taxpayer substantially. And the individuals owning that plan can take it with them. They owned it. Their family owned it if they had an error put on the plan. Very similar to a 401k. Not identical, but similar to the fact they owned it. They could take it. It was theirs. And they could contribute.
Okay.
So excuse me for my website having not having style put on there, but it was a 401k style. Now, if you've heard my speeches out there talking about it, I talk about it as a 401k style plan. A number of other municipalities in the state of Pennsylvania have now adopted the same type of plan to reduce their pension costs.
But the uniformed guaranteed pensions are still in place.
Yes, they are. There was no changing that.
According to your website, it said you had negotiations with the union to transfer from guaranteed pensions to
401k. Teamsters, yes. Teamsters. Yeah. That's non-uniform.
Yeah, but they're in place. According to your website, you've converted all the union contracts to 401k. That's not what it says.
You want to parse hairs on that now?
Yeah, well, it is because it's important. You're making representations about your record and what you did. And when I go to check, the guaranteed pensions are still in place. By your own admission, there is no 401k plan in place. According to your website, you transfer.
401k style.
Yeah. Okay. They have a cash balance pension plan, which is a guaranteed pension plan. That's not even close to a 401k plan.
You own it, you move it, you take it with you, yes.
But
it
it's
is.
Guaranteed.
When it's guaranteed.
A 401k is not guaranteed.
Understandable.
But so my point is this, is that you're saying you switch from guaranteed plans, union contract, to 401k. That's not correct. All those guaranteed pension plans are still in place.
Did you look at the rate reduction?
No, it's not in there. Because
so it's not in that report?
No. This is
so just, you need
this,
to get the rate reduction this, and you really need to compare apples to apples.
That's not my point. The point I'm making
because
is
it was a phenomenal savings to the taxpayer.
Is there not a 401k guaranteed
it's
pension?
It's a 401k style pension.
You
can move it and take it.
Okay.
In the state of Pennsylvania, you as a state
I guess
worker,
we're beating heads here, Ken. I guess the bottom line is
we
got
to take a break.
Yeah.
We'll be right back.
I'm a radio personality.
His diet consists of black coffee and sarcasm.
We'll be right back with Charlotte County Speaks on News Radio 1580 WCCF.
This is an actual headline, the Wall Street Journal right now, you know, talking about the Fed's next problem being oil prices, next challenge, $100 oil. The Fed can't do a damn thing about oil prices. First and foremost, they don't even take it into consideration, which again, they should. But what in the world are they going to do about it? Jay Powell and the economists going to get out their shovels? Are going to be like the Clampets there? They're going to try to find some oil for everybody to bring prices down?
Judy was boring.
Hello.
Then Judy discovered ChumbaCasino.com.
It's my little escape.
Now Judy's the life of the party.
Oh, baby, mama's bringing home the bacon.
Whoa, take it easy, Judy. The Chumba life is for everybody. So go to ChumbaCasino.com and play over 100 casino-style games. Join today and play for free for your chance to redeem some serious prizes. ChumbaCasino.com. No purchase necessary. Void where prohibited by law. 18 plus terms and conditions apply. See website for details.
Oh, I know. We're told. Oh, yes. We got green energy transition and windmills and solar panels. If that was the case, man, why is oil so expensive? I mean, you guys should be cutting into their business, but you're not. Again, they can't do a darn thing about it. And yes, is this going to filter into everything we buy? Are our prices going up? Yep. Damn straight they are. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com.
News Radio 1580, 100.9 FM, WCCF, Charlotte County Speaks on a hump day Wednesday, 10:19 is the time. Our guests are the curmudgeons and Dave Kalin, Joe Taseo. Now, are we shifting away from the 401k that's not a 401k?
Let's quit beating that dead horse.
I think Mr.
Kalin.
Get
into accusation of making these election things up here. It is you were on the canvassing team for 2022.
Yeah. Yes, correct. Yep.
Are you aware that in a single race there was almost 6,000 undervotes?
Yeah, I'd have to check with staff, but I perform my duties as a canvassing board member.
Substantial number of undervotes, which in the DS-200 is clumped in on that report with blank ballots. Now, I don't know if any of you have just read the report that just came out of Miami with over 86,000
blank
ballots.
Where were the undervotes? Were they spread out all over the place, or were they with one specific candidate?
It doesn't give the candidate to what the undervote was for. It just shows it up as an undervote. Now, we have requested the EL-45 audit tapes. It's actually a records tape that I'll actually go back on the DS-200 to the date that it was constructed. So you'll get every update, you'll get every ballot, and it also delineates between blank ballots and undervotes, because the form that is put out there for public consumption, the undervote, a blank ballot will show up as an undervote. But when you get the audit tapes, it actually delineates blank ballots.
So what's your claim?
So one of the other issues we have is chain of custody, understanding how important chain of custody is in an election. Did somebody mishandle ballots? Did they mishandle media? And there are 53 in the 2022 election cycle, 53 chains of custody forms. And of those 53, 15 of them are either there's no seals, there's no signatures, there's no proof of who handled what. That is a over 28% failure rate on chains of custody. That's a substantial number of failures. Hey, look right here. Nobody signed for it at the SOE's office to take that. This one, we don't know who handled those ballots, period, or the media. We get into this one, no seals, missing signatures.
Okay, well, it's almost 2024. What have you done with this information?
So what it has come down to is it's raised a lot of questions to what has happened, because we've heard over the past decade out of the former supervisor of elections that these were error-free elections. Well, they were anything but error-free elections. So my question to Mr. Tseo is, sitting on the canvassing board, you guys are responsible for adjudicating ballots.
Yes.
So how many blank ballots came across your personal hands to adjudicate?
Yeah, so we have something where the three of us is on the canvassing board. It would be me, Judge Bell, at the time it was a supervisor of elections. We would sit and look at ballots that would come in, mail-in ballots, and sometimes the ballots would come in with a mark on it where you'd leave your pen on a bubble, but then bubble in full the one below it. So we would have to make a determination as a commission and look at that and go, what was the voter intent? Was it the one where he laid the pen on and left a stray mark, or the one where he bubbled it in full? And we went through a whole host of those. They're all documented. By the way, it's all open to the public. It's videotaped. And anybody from the public who wants to witness that process was welcome to come in. I think Mr. Kalin, I think he came to maybe one or two times. He came in to check the machines when they were making sure they were calibrated properly. And then I think he came in one other time when we started the canvassing process, and then I didn't see him again. But all of this stuff is open and transparent. And the reason this is really at issue with me is that I listened to a candidate, Kalin, on a podcast that you were on. And it said, and I sent him an email as a candidate, and I sent it to him as a candidate, me as a voter. I said, on a podcast, you have included on your website as for Supervisor of Elections that you indicated you're a member of the election integrity team that concluded recent Charlotte County elections were disastrous. Can you please provide me with the name of the integrity team organization, its members, and the written findings, reports, or any documentation that determined our elections were disastrous? I'm a concerned citizen and super voter. These matters are very important for me. I didn't hear anything back from him. I sent a follow-up email a week later. I'm following up regarding my email below. I'm waiting for a response regarding this important matter. Because the problem is, you know, you can come in here with all these papers now. I don't know. I haven't seen any of it. I don't know what any of it means. So I'm requesting as a voter, where are your findings of fact so I can examine those things and see if there were errors in the election? So all of these claims are made. He won't even specify who's on the election team and what was their scope of the investigation and what were their written findings, so it can be scrutinized. On your show, he said he couldn't do that because he had whistleblowers and informants, and he didn't want to get them fired. So when I asked for the documents, that was what he said on the show. Am I not correct?
Mm-hmm.
Now he's got papers here saying, well, these are the problems. I just don't understand why.
Not the only problem. We can continue on.
I don't understand why Mr. Kalin, who's running on transparency, wraps himself in the cloak of privacy every time, whether it was with the taxes and he couldn't reveal who he was leasing property from. Now as a candidate, he claims he's on an election integrity team that said our elections in Charlotte County were a disaster. He said our officials were selected, not elected, is what he said. I'd like to know who selected our officials. I'd like to see the written findings of fact and the scope of your investigation and what this team is. He has provided none of that.
This is not my investigation. It's actually a team of folks going through the state, county by county.
You said you were on a team.
I'm on an election integrity team.
And you've determined that our elections in Charlotte County were a disaster and that our officials were selected, not elected.
Would you consider 28% of your chains of custody being not valid.
I asked you for findings of fact. Now you're throwing paper. I have not had the least opportunity to investigate any of it.
You were on the canvassing team.
But how am I? How
you
do I know?
On the canvassing board. These are documents you would all have access directly to.
You've provided me none of this when I requested it, and you wait to bring it out on a show.
They did
not.
They did not provide this till last week.
But how am I supposed to intelligently determine what those documents are? You have not provided, and I've requested it from you. And you say you can't give it to me because you'll get your informants in trouble. That's what you said.
Okay, so you got your informants. Yeah. Where are you going with this?
Yeah. So we're still requesting more documents. And originally we went back in December, January. We went to the governor's office as well as Cordburn's office. They were not interested at all. Don't rock the boat. They had other plans. And then we got election bill 7050. I guess now you can use your HOA card as voter ID. So nothing integrity about the new election integrity bill. So when you start to look at what went on in Charlotte County, and this is just one election cycle. Now we're waiting on those audit tapes. Once they come in, we will have a substantial number of things to look at. I'm not saying there was fraud. There's the appearance of some fraud.
Well, no, you said that they were a disaster. You said that the Charlotte County elections in 2022 were a disaster.
Yes. So if 28% of your ballots in your media are no longer valid because they don't have chain of custody signatures, we don't know who handled, who touched, where they went. That makes them null and void. Is that not disastrous? 28%.
If what you say is true.
This is straight from the elections office right here. These are their actual documents.
You turn those over to the authority and they refuse to do anything about it?
No, we just received these just recently. Incident reports. These are public record. Not all of them have been provided. I'm in possession of multiple additionals that were not included in the stack. 2020 ballots being found in the machines during the 2022 elections. Right there it is. If you're running a clean election where the machines are looked at, opened, scrutinized, accurate, you ran them through your testing, how are you getting 2020 ballots in your machines in 2022?
So the fact
that's disastrous.
Yeah. Okay.
So how do you certify the 2020 election if you're missing ballots?
So here's the deal. So there's a remedy, and that's why you have incident reports. By statute, you have to fill out these incident reports. And there's always an incident. That's why it's a statute throughout the state. Throughout all the states, I would imagine they have an incident report. Mm-hmm. Things go wrong, there's problems. So what you do is you have to fill out the incident report, whether it's the voter who fills it out or the poll worker who fills it out, and they sign it and send it in. And then there's a remedy. So if there's an issue, if there was a machine that had a ballot jammed in it or they had to replace a machine, all that's documented. And the reason Mr. Kalin has that is because of the transparency of the process. You have to fill out these documents so anybody from the public can see, number one, what the problem was, and number two, what was the remedy? Was the voter given an opportunity to revote because there was a problem with his ballot? And was that ballot marked void and sent in? There's always a process involved. But the point is this, is that I'm sending these written emails as a voter to a candidate. He didn't respond. He didn't even acknowledge that he got my emails.
Excuse my distrust of the government official who's pretending to be a constituent.
It's always an excuse. Now it's a government official. I sent these in. I signed it as a voter and taxpayer. I didn't sign it. I mean, I am a private person, too. I do have a life outside the commission, and I am a voter here in Charlotte County. I've been living here for 43 years, and I'm a super voter. I've been a registered Republican since 1987. I've voted in practically every election and every primary for all this time. So I signed this from my personal email address and signed it as a voter taxpayer. So now his excuse is for not responding is I'm a commissioner. I mean, how do you reconcile that? So there's always an excuse as to why not to respond to emails. I just don't get it when he's running on transparency. I respond to all my emails, even people who dislike me and don't like my policies. I respond. Mr. Kalin will attest to that. We've had our differences. I respond every single time. Every single time he has an issue, sends him an email. He's got my personal cell phone number. Personal, and I would still, if he called me today with a problem, I'm his public servant. I would still respond regardless of our differences. So my point is that he's running on transparency. He refuses to respond to these things. And then I was at a private REC meeting and tapped him on the shoulder and said, Mr. Kalin, I said, Dave, you haven't responded to my emails. I said, what's going on? And then he said, it's privacy and this and that, and he doesn't want to disclose his sources. And then that was it. And I went back to my seat. And then he describes that as, what did he say? I lost my crap.
You lost your crap.
I didn't lose my crap. I asked him. You were sitting at the table and his wife, there was like three or four people. I simply tapped you on the shoulder and said, hey, we're so much for a transparent candidate. And I went back to my table. There was no scene. I didn't yell or shout.
There's a bit of a scene.
There wasn't a scene. I had Commissioner Deutsch was at the table next door. I said, did you see me talking to Kalin? He said, yeah, you talked to him and went back to your table.
Oh, look at the time.
Here's a quick secret about today's show. They're making toast down the hall. Ever notice toasters are like the radio? You turn them on and they work. No pesky upgrades needed. Sometimes you have to shake out the crumbs. And that goes for the toaster, too. Mmm. That wonderful smell of toast. Oh, enjoy the show.
We'll be right back with Charlotte County Speaks on News Radio 1580 W.
But with that responsibility comes the scrutiny of the public. I go through it when I was a candidate. I go through it as an elected official. I try not to take it personally. People ask me a lot of questions and send me emails. I respond to everybody. Anybody who wants to speak to me personally, I respond. That's just the way it is in this world. So I guess my point is I've sent Mr. Kalin emails as a commissioner, and I sent him as a private voter. He's been non-responsive. And a lot of this may have been prevented if he would just respond to these things and we could get to the bottom of it. But what happens is he only responds in public forums when I don't have the ability to have a back and forth. It's either at a public hearing or something like that, or a radio show where he's producing all these documents that I have no idea. I haven't seen any of this stuff.
As we just discussed.
He hasn't responded to these emails.
I addressed at the same time with a lot of this, right before all this came down, I was addressing some code issues with some state statutes with you, and you did respond. I called you. We had a conversation, and your words to me were,
Judy was boring.
Hello.
Then Judy discovered ChumbaCasino.com.
It's my little escape.
Now Judy's the life of the party.
Oh, baby, mama's bringing home the bacon.
Whoa, take it easy, Judy. The Chumba life is for everybody. So go to ChumbaCasino.com and play over 100 casino-style games. Join today and play for free for your chance to redeem some serious prizes. ChumbaCasino.com. No purchase necessary. Void where prohibited by law. 18 plus. Terms and conditions apply. See website for details.
My brother-in-law died suddenly, and now my sister and her kids have to sell their home. That's why I told my husband we could not put off getting life insurance any longer. An agent offered us a 10-year, $500,000 policy for nearly $50 a month. Then we called SelectQuote. SelectQuote found us identical coverage for only $19 a month, a savings of $369 a year.
Whether you need a $500,000 policy or a $5 million policy, SelectQuote could save you more than 50% on term life insurance.
For your free quote, go to SelectQuote.com. SelectQuote.com. That's SelectQuote.com.
SelectQuote. We shop, you save. Full details on example policies at SelectQuote.com/commercials.
You seem to be the only farmer having any problems with Charlotte County. And that's patently not true because it's not my farm. It's somebody else's farm that I lease space from. Unfortunately, they've looked at me for the help, which then I reached out to you for the help.
Right.
And then I got a slap in the face as, oh, it's only you. It's only that's not, you.
You actually took that personal. I mean, come
actually,
on.
I did take it personally.
Here's how it
so when I've got a government official who I feel is not working in my best interest, I'm going to have a little bug up my butt over it, and I'm not going to be providing anything to you.
Okay. Well, it's good to know.
I'd like to have a sit down with you.
I've asked for it.
And I'm finally back on track, back to getting out and doing things again.
Okay.
So maybe you want to come on out to my farm, and we'll have a little sit down. We'll talk. We'll go through some documents. I'll show you some information. We'll talk about the code cases that are going on that are in blatant violation of the Right to Farm Act.
Here's the context of that comment I made to Mr. Kalin. He was telling about all these issues he was having. I go, that's kind of strange. You seem to be the only one having this many issues. I don't get a lot of calls from people with code compliance like I have from him. That's how it was, but he characterizes it as a slap in the face. It was just a call like, hey, Dave, it's funny. I haven't heard these kind of complaints before. You seem to be the only one who has this much stuff. What's going on? It wasn't a slap in the face, but yeah, he uses that as an excuse not to respond and basically, what do they call that? Not doxing, but he doesn't respond to
anything.
He ghosts me. I mean, that's unbelievable.
Did you come attend any of the code hearings? I told you about the ones that were coming up.
I would have been great if you would actually come into the code hearing. I watched
and
every
have a
one
conversation
of them video.
With us.
Here's the thing: we have a special magistrate. We're not supposed to influence them. It's an independent, quasi-judicial hearing. There's no place for a commissioner in those meetings. However, I watched them virtually. I watched both of them. One ended up in a continuance, and the second time went to another continuance. So yes, I did watch them. I listened to your argument with the code, and I listened. And staff was going to come back and do a continuance. So
that's
yes,
where we come
I'm paying
sit down
attention.
And
I'm
we
paying
talk
attention
about
to
what
all
they're
the
doing, and maybe you can propose a change to the ordinance that clarifies state statutes, so that we don't have to waste our time going to code hearings for things that are a state an agricultural right issue.
Well, like I said, right now you seem to be the only one with code compliance regarding that particular issue. So
it's
we're going to
not me.
We're
it's gonna, partner farms.
Yeah. So our legal department and the official, they're going to look into this and come back with a resolution and see if you are consistent with the state law or not. Because we don't want to rewrite the law, right? So right now they're interpreting your argument. If you're correct, they will rule in your favor, right? If not, then they'll have some type of bona fide argument as to why you're not entitled to certain things on that property. So I don't want to rewrite the laws and create more laws and more government. Right now, you have your due diligence that you're afforded, and you're going through the proper venue. So let's see how it all plays out after the continuance. Then, if there needs to be a change, I'd be more than happy to look at that. But I am following your code case. But no, I'm not in the room, but I am watching it. Because you don't want a commissioner
so
in the room.
I'm going to ask you right now, will you sit down with the three farms I'm working with right now that I lease part of, will you sit down and have a meeting with all of us?
Number one, I've offered myself multiple times. I've never turned down a meeting.
For that case, will you do that?
Well, no. Here's the thing. It's going through code compliance. I do not want to get involved, as I said, as a commissioner. You're in a quasi-judicial meeting. When it's over, then I'll get involved. But there's a trial going on, so to speak. I can't get involved. It's not my purview. It's independent of us, so we don't influence code
compliance.
Absolutely.
But how about bringing yourself up on the education of what the Florida statutes are and what we're dealing with?
Yeah, I've read your Right to Farm Act. I've read all of that. And
it's
not
my Right to Farm Act. That's the state statute.
Okay. I've read it and looked at it. I'm not a lawyer, but I do understand the tenets of what's in there. But you're in the right place, and that's why you're in the right venue through the code compliance and the special magistrate to hear your complaints.
But
and hopefully we'll come to a resolution that everyone gets educated.
But had we not held their feet to the fire, these farms would have been shut down.
Okay, so it's like I said before, you have incident reports there, and then there's a resolution and remedy. Same with code compliance. The code compliance isn't there to fine you and put you in jail. It's there to get you compliant with the ordinance. So you're entitled to due diligence in this hearing process, and that's what you're going through now. You're exercising your rights to make your case in the right venue. So let's see how it all plays out. But I definitely do not want to insert myself in the middle of a hearing.
Well,
I can't do that.
Let's take that one out of the equation right now. How many times I've asked for the Board of Commissioners to come out and meet with me and meet with my team in the ranchettes, because we pretty know what's going on out there versus the one or two employees that you guys have talked to. I've asked multiple times for that board to come out, and not once have I seen you out there with me. I've asked you to come out.
I've never had a request to come out and meet with you.
I did it at the commissioner's meetings. Came in and I said, we will take each one of you out. Anybody that wants to go, we will take you out and run you through out there.
Well, so did you send me an email? Hey, let's get set up with a, you know, to meet. I mean, I don't remember that.
I've had phone conversations with you on it and said, hey, come on out. So I don't need to come out.
No. Okay. Well, I don't remember any of that. At the hearing,
you even said, I've been out there many times.
No, one of the people you were with asked me if I'd come out there. I said, yeah. They said they have some type of group that gets together. I'm like, yeah, just send me an email. I'll get it on my calendar. No, there was a lady you were with that asked me. I don't know who her name was.
Oh, okay.
She asked me. I said, yeah, that's fine.
She does not live out there. Yeah. So
all I'm saying is I'm responsive to my requests and my constituents. So, you know, that's my point. And you seem to be in the right venue for your code compliance, and we'll see how it all plays out. Yeah.
All right. Final break, and we'll be right back.
Coming up, America's hottest new curse word, Kleeman. We'll tell you what it means after this.
We'll be right back with Charlotte County Speaks on News Radio 1580 WCCF.
I'm trying to get smart. I've been watching Nova. You seen that show? They had a thing a couple of weeks ago about string theory. I started watching that at 8 p.m. And at 8:03, my brain exploded. They said string theory is the stuff that the physicists are now figuring out that Albert Einstein was not able to nail down in his theories. Something, well, if Albert Einstein didn't understand it, me on a couch with a bag of potato chips don't have a shot. Oh, I see what they're talking about. Yeah, you got to incorporate gravity. I was wondering why he didn't do that. I'm sitting there working on my string cheese theory. You know, they always say Albert Einstein was a genius. Then how come when anyone ever calls you that, it's an insult? You don't know where you parked the car. Good job, Einstein. I don't think we're honoring that man properly.
He's got Kenny.
Continuing education.
He's got
wonderful.
Those Lovejoy eyes.
So we got a few minutes left.
I think there's a song in there, right? Write that down.
Yeah,
right.
I will.
Okay, so, you know, I know we just have a few minutes left. So I just wanted to, you know, because we just got done with our budget hearing, and I know, you know, Dave is running for supervisor elections. And, you know, he also ran for county commissioner, and you know, he was at our budget hearings talking about, you know, tax increases and things like that. So, I mean, I just looked at his voting record when he was commissioner. His very first vote when he got sworn in came 2 weeks later. It was a very big vote. It was to vote for the township manager. It's probably the biggest vote you can make as an elected official because you're hiring the person that's going to administer the county day-to-day operations. He abstained from voting for the township manager after being a sitting commissioner for 2 weeks. I don't know how that can happen.
I can explain that right now.
Now, in the minutes, it says he didn't take part in the interviews. So if I'm a candidate running for office and I'm going to be prepared to serve on day one, as soon as I get elected, the first thing I'm going to do is ask for all the resumes and set up interviews because I had 2 weeks to make the vote. I would have been prepared to vote because at the very next meeting, he voted for pay raises and bonuses for management and staff. He seconded a motion to double the sewer rates, and it passed. He made a motion to increase resident fees and children's fees for the playground program. The next year, he seconded a motion to prepare and advertise an ordinance levying tax on earned income and net profits. He proposed and passed an ambulance tax on top of the 0.20 millage already in place. He made a motion to create fees for gatherings. In 2013, he seconded a motion to raise the millage rate for the general fund and the fire fund. He again voted to raise the sewer rates 8.25% and voted to raise the garbage fees in multiple years 6.5%. Now, in reading the minutes, there are reasons for all of those things. I understand as a commissioner, right? Inflation, things change, there's demands, level of service issues. at some point you have to look at your fee structure and say, maybe we need to make changes here. So I'm not saying this because against Mr. Kalin. I'm sure in reading the minutes there were reasons for these raises, right? But what he doesn't do is recognize when we have these same raises and we go through the exact same evaluation that he did when he raised fees as commissioner, when he did it, it's okay. When we do it, it's no good. So that's my point, is that somebody who comes into the chamber and talks about smaller government, lower taxes, eliminate this, eliminate that, the record shows there was not a fee tax that he did not pass or was the motion maker. The ambulance tax was actually something he brought up, and in the minutes, he's recognized as that's his tax that he proposed to get passed on top of the 0.20 millage. I understand why he did it. Capital needs, things like that, those are the same things we grapple with here.
That was a state mandate.
Yeah. No, it wasn't.
Actually, it was.
I have the minutes
state,
right here.
The state of Pennsylvania mandated ambulance service at
what
all municipalities.
What about the sewer fees? What about the sewer fees and all the other fees I just
mentioned? Sewer fees had not been increased in years.
Yeah.
Well, years. So the previous board patted themselves on the backs for no tax increase for over 10 years. That's not responsible government.
Okay.
People cannot budget a massive tax increase.
You had your reasons.
At the 10-year
point. Yeah, you had your reasons.
You do a tiny amount over time. You actually make more money as a government because you have the amortized rate rather than a lump sum at the end. So you actually do better on that.
Yeah.
But people can budget and handle for it. When we have these huge increases, it's not sustainable.
You doubled the sewer rates in 1 year.
You doubled them. Was bankrupted.
Okay.
There was no money
You had
left.
Your reasons. And
so
I get that.
When we get into the ambulance tax, the state mandated that you were required to provide emergency ambulance service to your residents. We went out and did a study. Did you look up the study?
Yeah.
Because the study was millions a year. We entered into a $155,000 a year contract with Southern Berks Ambulance Association.
I give you all of that. I qualified my question with
that was doing the due diligence, looking at every angle. How do we keep this as cost effective as possible? When I look at things like the gateways, those are feel-good items.
It's a public safety item. If you look at the actual quote, it was for sidewalks and crosswalks.
If you've got people walking at the intersection of Kings Highway, that's insanity.
Yeah.
Have you ever walked that intersection?
Yeah. So there's
because I've done flag wavings out there. Nobody should be walking those intersections.
You know why? There's no sidewalks and crosswalks.
There are sidewalks and crosswalks there. And you're begging to get killed.
No, the quote you said with the sign, that was just one small component. The $900,000 was for a sidewalk system, crosswalks, and infrastructure to get you through that whole quadrant of seven to make it safer.
How much a year? It wasn't about
a sign.
How much a year does the county spend on
palm trees
and beautification down 41?
This is the dodge. So I guess the bottom line is Mr. Kalin also raised taxes when his record shows. And like I said, he probably had good reason to. We didn't raise our fire rate for 4 years. It was the same. So I'm using the same argument he just used. It was stagnant. We could not hold the cost down anymore.
But that was so under your tutelage.
But my point, four years
you didn't do it, and now you hit with a massive increase
rather than
a small amount over time when you had the opportunity. Okay. I come into office, and I'm inheriting the 08 collapse mess.
Here's the bottom line. You've raised taxes, fees, and assessments while you're a commissioner. Bottom line. That's the bottom line. It happens when you're an elected official because we have to grapple with the reality of providing services, and we have to make tough decisions.
Well, there's a difference between wants and needs.
Yeah, so I get that. Well, listen, I'm telling you, so some of this stuff here, in terms of the rates, it's not a want for us. When we raise sewer rates or we look at rates, it's because we have a demonstrated need, and it has to be. Otherwise, we're going to be eating away our reserve fund, and we can't be in that place because we'll lower our credit rating. You can only eat away so much at reserves before you put the county in a really bad position. But like I said, I understand Mr. Kalin when he's commissioner, because as I read through the minutes, there may have been good reasons to raise the fees and taxes.
You're just saying that he's not giving you the same understanding now that he's on the other side.
On the other side. He comes in and he basically reads us the Riot Act that we're tax and spend community and we're out of control, when in fact his record shows every year he was in office, he raised fees, assessments, and taxes.
Well,
that's the bottom line.
But with him,
he's got an excuse for it. With me, I'm not entitled to the same thing.
Pardon me for being a bit jaded. As a resident of the Charlotte Ranchettes, the redheaded stepchild of the Charlotte County, we get no services out there other than trash. And most of us are waiting for that to end up happening out at the main entrances and not at our homes.
Have you guys asked to be annexed into the county?
They won't take us. They won't even entertain taking us back.
That bad, huh?
No, number one, they are in the county.
We're unincorporated.
They're part of the county.
We are part of the county, but we're unincorporated.
Yeah.
And the roads were originally set up. So the Charlotte Ranchettes was originally legislated, not approved by the county. So I'm going to apologize for comments 8 years ago. You weren't on the board, I believe, at the time, with the situation of the Ranchettes being the county's issue. That was a state legislated issue. The state needs to step up and help. But when the county walked away in 21 and said, we're not doing anything to maintain roads, your MSBU is gone. And at the same hearing, when our public works director said, and we're probably not maintaining any drainage either because of your roads, that violates Stormwater 298.
So here's the thing. Those roads are not owned by the county. The right-of-way, they're privately owned roads. There's an easement that the public can use them, but it's not ours. A previous commission, I think, some years ago, might have been 2002 or maybe it was 92, agreed to start doing maintenance and create an MSBU. They should have never done that. It was a private road community. So it was never set up to be a county-maintained road. It was a commission who made a decision because some of the residents said, look, we can't do this ourselves. You need to create some type of taxing district so we can collect revenues and do the roads.
But 298 still applies. You are required to take care of stormwater.
Well, if we are, then the statutes would dictate and somehow there'd be a consent decree or something saying we have to do it. We haven't gotten that.
That's coming.
Well, then fine. When we get that, then we'll deal with it. But right now, it's not a public road. It's a private road with a public easement. We're not supposed to be maintaining that road. The citizens are. And that's a community that they bought into because that's the kind of lifestyle that's out there. But anyway, my point is this. You know, there's a lot of things that are said out there in the public, you know, and accusations made. But really, when you boil it down and look at the record of Mr. Kalin, I think he should reflect on his time on the Township Commission and look at what he went through and look at what we're dealing with. There's going to be a lot of similarities there. And I'm really surprised, being that he was a commissioner, he understands the position I'm in. And not responding, knowing that I reach out the way I do, and he was in that position before, it's beyond me why he hasn't been more forthcoming in having meetings to sit down and resolve issues. Because that's what commissioners do. We provide solutions. We try not to make problems. We're solution makers. And if the other party's not willing to talk and engage, it becomes very difficult. And I hold him to a higher standard because he was an elected official. He ran for Charlotte County Commissioner last year, and he's running for Supervisor of Election. There's a courtesy there, and that's my point. And like I said, I can understand your voting record and the reasons, but we're not afforded the same thing.
So take my wisdom on that. Cleaning up the mess of what the previous boards had put in Charlotte or into Coomer Township and the experience to pull us out of that hole and do it responsibly, take a little wisdom from that. Just because you can tax for it doesn't mean you should tax for it.
Look, I proposed last year to lower the millage rate, and we did, and it stayed low. So 2 years in a row, the millage rate has been lowered. I proposed that because right.
I appreciate that.
We're out of time. Thank you, curmudgeons, for being good little boys. Go ahead.
We love you to death okay. With your love joy eyes.
Talk to you tomorrow. Bye, kids.
Anybody got any more jokes? Anything funny? No? All right. See you, folks.
Uncle Nearest is the most awarded bourbon and American whiskey for 2020, 2021, and 2022. Blended by four-time Master Blender of the Year, Victoria Edie Butler, the great-great-granddaughter of Nearest Green, the first known African-American master distiller.